Znajduję się właśnie na pasie startowym w niewielkiej wiosce Tekin w prowincji Oksapmin. To właśnie tutaj zakończyła się nasza blisko dwumiesięczna ekspedycja w Papui Nowej Gwinei. Za nami mnóstwo przeżyć. Chcielibyśmy się podzielić z Wami kilkoma z nich.
Kwestia prywatności była dla nas problemem przez całą ekspedycję. Także na przykład po całym dniu chodzenia chcę się wykąpać, więc pytam pierwszą lepszą panią, gdzie jest strumień. Pani zaprowadza mnie do strumienia, a tam dziesiątki ludzi. No i jak tutaj się wykąpać? Pytam się lokalnych, jak wy się kąpiecie? No to zazwyczaj wtedy dziesiątki dziewczyn podśmiewają się i mówią, no w ciuchach się kąpiemy. No to nie pozostaje nic innego, jak tylko zanurzyć się w całej koszulce, w całych spodniach. No i możecie sobie wyobrazić, jak to po prostu całym się jest mokrym, wcale się jest nieumytym, bo jak to się umyć, jak wszyscy się na ciebie patrzą. Ale kulminacją tych problemów z prywatności była dla mnie pewien poranek w jednej z wiosek. Wieczorem dostaliśmy od ludzi papryczki chili, które użyliśmy do kolacji. No i niestety mój organizm zbuntował się, także rano wstałam i szybko biegnę do toalety. I tu toalety są tutaj, tak jak widzicie za mną, jest taki drewniany domek zbudowany z pali. W środku zazwyczaj nie ma drzwi i w środku mamy dziurę, w którą musimy trafić, załatwiając swoje potrzeby. No więc pilnie do takiej toalety wchodzę, załatwiam swoje sprawy na kucaka, tak jak tutaj jestem teraz, drzwi brak. I widzę, jak przechodzą koło mnie dwie panie. I co? Machają mi. Ja się załatwiam, a one mi machają. No to grzecznie odmachuję im, ale co, one na to idą w moją stronę. Więc odganiam je szybko, na szczęście w końcu zrozumiały.
Gdyby spytał mnie ktoś, co było dla mnie najtrudniejsze w czasie tej ekspedycji, to właśnie kwestia toalet. Ale ciężko też było sobie poradzić ze sławą. Gdziekolwiek się nie ruszyliśmy, witały nas tłumy. No i jak tu się z tymi wszystkimi ludźmi powitać? Kolejna opowieść z Papui Nowej Gwinei tyczy się kwestii powitań.
Oj, cała wioska przychodzi nam z powitaniem, cała.
Tak, powitanie jest bardzo ważną kwestią. No i przychodzą zawsze najmłodsi, najstarsi, kobiety i panie. No i tych dzieci jest zawsze bardzo dużo we wiosce. Po prostu tłumy i tych dzieci, no nikt właściwie ich nie liczy. Jak się mówi, jaka liczba jest mieszkańców w wiosce, nigdy się dzieci nie uwzględnia, bo nikt ich właściwie do tej pory nie policzył. No ale z tymi dziećmi też się trzeba przywitać, no bo one chcą nam podać rękę. I Karolina wymyśliła sobie genialny sposób, jak witać się z tymi dziećmi. Bo dzieci są troszeczkę, można powiedzieć, zaniedbane. Zawsze smarki im tutaj lecą, tędy, uszami, z nosa, wszędzie. Na chusteczek higienicznych nie ma, no to zawsze tymi rękami sobie tutaj podcierają. No i te ręce są całe, no powiedzmy wprost, w glutach. No i podać takiemu dziecku rękę, no też kupa bakterii, nie? Ale z kolei przywitać się wypada. No i genialny pomysł, jaki wymyśliła Karolina, co robi? Podchodzi do dziecka i zbija mu piątkę. Kontakt krótki, sekunda, powitanie z głowy.
No ale najlepsze ze wszystkiego są starsze panie. Więc zazwyczaj sytuacja wygląda tak. My idziemy i już widzimy szeroki uśmiech starszej pani i zazwyczaj zaczyna się od tego, że ona zaczyna krzyczeć i coś takiego, takie mniej więcej dźwięki wychodzą z jej ust. No i przychodzi do uścisku dłoni. I w terenach Oksapminu to jest długi uścisk dłoni. Taki uścisk dłoni jest jak pralka, więc
jedna ręka
zaciska się na drugiej. I trzęsiemy.
Pół minuty,
i pani zaczyna jeszcze śpiewać, bo tak się cieszy, że widzi białego i oj, i to trwa. I ona zaczyna mówić w swoim języku. I mówi. I no i nie wiadomo, co zrobić. Chcemy wziąć tą rękę, ale nie da się. I trzęsiemy. I to trwa i minuty, i dwie. Oj, te starsze panie to naprawdę wytrzęsły te nasze ręce. I jeszcze ilość tych ludzi, z jakimi się witamy.
Także
jedna pani i później kolejne dwie minuty. Już chcemy wyjść z wioski, a to nie. Z każdym trzeba się pożegnać, z każdym trzeba się przywitać i to zazwyczaj zajmuje nam co najmniej 20 minut.
Tak.
Ha 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 ha!
No jest też łagodniejsza forma przywitań, głównie stosowana pomiędzy mężczyznami, ale kobiety też to stosują. Wygląda to mniej więcej tak, że wita się z drugą osobą, zaczyna się od zwykłego podania sobie ręki, ale tuż po tym podaniu sobie ręki następuje kliknięcie kostek. Ale jest jeden problem, który zawsze my napotykaliśmy, to jest, czy my wsadzamy komuś palec, czy ktoś wsadza palec nam. No i zazwyczaj się tak kończyło, że zderzaliśmy się tą ręką, no i nie byliśmy w stanie wyciągnąć tego kliknięcia. A wśród miejscowych to kliknięcie jest naprawdę głośne. Jak część z Was może wie, na początku ekspedycji mieliśmy pewną sytuację, która troszkę nas załamała, a mianowicie nasza ratunkowa akcja helikopterem. No i chcielibyśmy Wam pokazać, jak cała akcja wyglądała ze strony naszego kolegi Rambo.
Tivalmin first home. My brother Michael sent me down to Tivalmin village. He gave me a map and GPS coordinates nowhere. And above sea level, maybe 2400 above sea level. I got that number and then walked down to Tivalmin. From Swam to Tivalmin. 9 o'clock I leave you at Swam. And I walk down to Tivalmin maybe 19 to 1. I arrive down there at Tivalmin. And then I see 6 white men at the Halimbed area. And then I walked, go through there, and I gave the GPS number and map. I gave them, and then they see that number, and they all 6 white men, American men, they confused that GPS number and map. So I tell them, because I want a solo pilot to come here. And then I gave this GPS number to a solo pilot. And then solo pilot, he see this number and he said, at the back of this mountain, where the leg is, first home. Then I said, yes, yes, yes. Then they asked me question, how many white men are there? Only 2 and 1 PNG man. And that lady is sick. I was tremendously close to her and she was dead. She was dead. I told, speak to pilot, and pilot said, oh, okay, 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 he said. And then he go and start the sofa, and then he came up to first swamp. From there, that GPS coordinates number I gave to security, ring down to OTML base 1. And then OTML base, they received that number, GPS number, and one is man, he came from Pramin. He received that number and then he passed that number to Sova pilot, and then he arranged the big Sova from OTML, heavy lift. He received that number and then he come up to Tivalmin. Tivalmin, so that time Sova land there, and then I see that the other big Sova had coming at the back. Then we land there and then we just transit from small Sova to big Sova. Then we come down, from there we go to the Indonesian side, from Octarium Mine to Tivalmin. From Tivalmin to Indonesia is roughly about 18 kilometers. Then we follow the international border line down to nearest to the Ningrum. From there we follow the Okma Road, come straight to the Tabubil. Abbot, from Abbot we land there and see same time ambulance car come alive there with the OTML security car around there. Okay, then Carolina and Michael hop into the old ambulance car, and then they come straight up to the hospital. Me and Kevin, we stay there at the airport. From there we walk into the domestic table, and then we came out from that. And then I woke up, from there I woke up to the hospital, and Kevin stayed there.
Po akcji helikopterowej zdecydowaliśmy się zmienić cele naszej ekspedycji. Zjechaliśmy na południe do Kyungi i tam zaopatrzyliśmy się w różne produkty, które miały nam się przydać w czasie dalszej wędrówki. O jednej z historii opowie wam Kevin.
Yeah, the time okay, we went to a big store and Michael, I was asking Michael, please just buy me one gumboot, pair of gumboot. So he said, okay, you can look for a gumboot and make. So on the shelves, there's so many gumboots were there. So I bought this gumboot. This gumboot was fat like this. They were thin here. So it was like that. So I buy this gumboot and put it on the shelf counter. So I put my leg on this side, not the other side, just on this side and then just fit my leg. And it was okay for me to wear this. So then I buy this and then hold it and take it to the house. So I didn't cut this rope. So I just take the pair to the house for prepare myself for the next day journey up to Dalmo. And then on the way now, next early in the morning, in the morning, Dingy came to the saw on the wolf, and we all get onto the dinghy. The dinghy was just like
very long, very long and very narrow.
It was like this. Yeah, the dinghy was like just like this, narrow very long, like this. And then we all there, and then Karina and Michael there sit in front of me, and then at the back was so big, 20 liters containers just. At the back of me.
200 liters of fuel, yeah.
200 liters of fuel. And then backside was the controller. The driver was at the back. And then just backside me was a containers. And in front of me, like this Kevitz, in front of me was a live chicken there.
Chicken that we bought in Kyunga the day before.
Live chicken was here. So hard for me to stretch like a treadmill, eh? But so it was sitting there. And there was a family all went down. And then I licked myself and sit. All my gumboots just in front of me and then I sit. And I was sitting. I think that I was so comfortable as I sit. I don't know how many hours we took on the river, I don't know. So I sit relaxed and just enjoying myself and sitting. And then we start to ride now. We come up all the way. On the way now, I start want to feel my stretch, so my leg was so tight, so I just stretch my leg. No, the chicken cries. So I just hurt. To make it worse, the chicken is kicked so big there. And I just saw Mr. Smell was coming up, and I just turned my face towards the side. No, there was drums continually. The heart for me to stretch, the heart for me to put my legs. I was just, smell just hit me. Just so I avoided it. Hard for me, I thought that I was sick. To make it worse, I was standing there for just, I don't like this man. I don't like a stand stone, sitting there a whole day till in the afternoon.
How many hours we spent in Dinghy?
About
14 hours sitting with this chicken.
I was sitting and smelling this excreta for 14 hours. All day, just this thing just make me so tired, and I didn't laugh to even, hard for me to sleep, hard for me to stress like this.
But the same evening, you took revenge on that chicken.
Yes, in the same evening, I just killed this chicken, and it was a very complicated journey that I, whole day, to make it, was the sun was so strong that hitting, fine place to hate myself, cover myself very, because it's too narrow. It was,
and the sun was heating up the excreta, so the smell was even
worse. Sun was hitting this excreta, the smell coming this way, and then just to turn myself this way, the fuel containers there, the smell of fuel, I just make me so. That was I thought that I will sick now. I will not complete my journey now. I was thinking like that.
Oh, it's good memory.
That was the thing that I was make this more complicated part in the journey. And in the evening now, early in the morning, okay, I tried to wear this soon now. I didn't test, wearing the soon. Early in the next morning, okay, I put my legs into this gumboot and then cut the rope pins here and then I wear it. And then I didn't realize it. And then on maybe 5 kilometers now, 5 kilometers now, we walk 5 kilometers, I feel like this leg was moving so excessively in the gumboot, while this was stuck permanently. And I was thinking, why this leg is moving all inside the gumboot? It's so moving. And I surprised to see that I checked sizes here. Oh, this gumboot was size 10 and this gumboot was size 7.
Oh,
I was blaming the Chinese people. Chinese, you confuse me why you make stick to this gumboot. Two different sizes in gumboots. Chinese just confused me. I was thinking if I go back to Kyunga, I'm going to change this gumboot. But, and then that plane was didn't work out because there was a hole in the size 10 gumboot. There was a hole in there. Oh, Chinese, they are fake ones. I was complaining to Kansas. Fake Chinese. And that's how did we make this complication so interesting at the same time. Everything I realize, so many things happen in our journey. Beautiful journey, 100% I love this journey.
Papui Nowej Gwinei transport odbywa się głównie na nogach, więc jeśli chcemy coś przenieść, musimy mieć do tego dobrą torbę. Torby robią miejscowi. Robią je z kory drzewa, którą potem przeplata się specjalną nić, no i szydełkuje i powstaje taka piękna, rozciągająca się torba, która nazywa się bilum. Bilum stanowi doskonały prezent, ale niełatwo znaleźć odpowiedni kolor.
Kevin, do you remember that day when I asked you if we can try to get pink bilum for my sister's daughter?
Yes, that was in my mind. That was in my mind at that time. Okay, in Sarapti, one of the guys, his name Utinskam, and so I was sitting there, and I was repeating that same question. Do you have any bilum selling in here?
Yep, many.
Do you sell any bilum in here?
Yeah, many.
Pink.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you understand what is pink?
Yeah, pink.
This thing, pink, whole bilum pink. Yeah. Do you understand that?
Yeah.
That man clearly didn't understand any English. He just said pink, white bilum.
It is like this one, and I explained to you in Pidgin.
Not three.
And then he was explained to me like traditional bilum in pink, but whole bilum must be colored in pink.
Not and blue, not white.
Not white.
Pink.
Yeah.
But then at some point, fortunately at the end of our journey, Sister Benny had a pink bilum and she understood a beautiful little pink bilum.
Yeah.
So they saved.
Nie wszystkie historie były zabawne. Niektóre z nich były naprawdę wzruszające, jak ta, która przydarzyła się w czasie naszej drogi Kevinowi.
Okay, there was a history that I've been married to a woman in Bimin, and we divorced for so long, approximately 13 years ago. And somehow, somewhat, I worked with Carolina and Michael from Kyunga to Oksapmin. During that journey, on the way, I was so stressed and my appearance looked different. And then maybe Carolina was maybe thinking that I said or something like that, but I know that I have a wife and kids and I divorced them. So our destiny, our route now is we're going to meet them on the way. So I was thinking how and what way I must make sure not to cross this village, but somehow I must go. Because if they see me on the way, if they see me on the way, there must be maybe a little bit conflict might happen. So I was thinking and I was so worried too. At the same time, I'm scared too. Something like that was happening. I was thinking, meeting and planning. What are the routes that I'm going to travel through? So I just made a quick thought plan in my mind that I think we leave this place in night will be okay because people will not see me. One of the thinking thoughts that I just came was that I'm a man. I can pass through that road. I don't care. If they want to fight or if they want to do anything else, it's okay. I'm just submit myself to them. I made a wrong. That thought was big in me. And then we passed through this village, nothing happened. We go to the school and we slept there with my uncle's wife, Uncle Freddy slept there, and then at the same time we arrived there at 3 o'clock when the school children were finished off from school. And then my small daughter, just she clicked me, she saw me, because she knows me, but the firstborn kid, Jadid, never knows me. So girl saw me, her name is Jokobeth. So she came close to me, second with them. And then we go and rest there, sit there, there because all of us were tired. So we there, and then whole crowd, whole students were just circling us. We were in the center. My son want to just see my face. What kind of father my father is? He want to really want to see me, and I also was intending to see him because I don't know his face too. I asked my daughter, please, I want to see my son. Is he along here or he went home already to the house? And then the daughter said, he's here, but he's scared. He's so scared that, what kind of father? Oh, he want to see you. He also want to see you. He's just standing at the back of the student and at the back of hiding in the flower garden to see me. But I didn't see him. Unfortunately, I didn't see him. He went away. So in the night, we cook a rice packet there, and we serve rice there. And then there was extra plate there, and I was thinking, this extra plate, I'm going to feed it for my son. And in the morning, the daughter came inside, and I was asking the daughter, "Where is the son? I want to see him." And then the daughter said, "Oh, he's outside." And then I told him, "There was here 150 kina here, plus the rice pot. This 150 kina is given to you, blessings from Michael and Carolina. You need to get this 150 kina plus this rice pot. So not you alone, but let your brother to come, and you can say this one." And then the second time, Siki went out to pick him up, and then they both of them come. And then when I saw my son, oh, please, just make me cry, because 13 years I've been without him, and I didn't know him. His face, he didn't know my face. So we were hold hands together, we were crying, my tears dropped. And then they both come inside, eat this rice. I gave them this 150 kina. They were crying, and then we satisfied. And then when we were crying, now whole student saw me. They saw me, that oh, father just hugged them. We were made a big cry. We put our heads together, cry, because for long, 13 years, I have not been with them. In the afternoon now, the news about us was spread to the communities that, oh, Kevin was with the children. He have not been looked after these kids for 13 years. So they made a complaint to me, and that we want to see this guy. Why he is talking with this student? Because this student were not brought by him. He's brought by these parents. And then in the afternoon now, Rambo and I, we go to the village. I was so scared to what kind of question they're going to ask me. I also was scared. I also was preparing what are the words that I'm going to introduce with them. And then I was just, all my mind was just empty, no words left now. And I was just clicking Rambo, please give me some words, help me with some words, so that we can convince them, and then whatever things that they brought comes to their minds must be finished. And then we just so brave, so we go along the village with these two kids. They lead us, and then all the way to the village. Village now, I was surprised to see whole the community were crowded there. And in the center, pastor living there, and then the community elder was in the center. And they were expecting, and the wife that I divorced her also was sitting at the side. And I was thinking, what are the words that they're going to give me? Will they going to punish me, or maybe they kill me, or... I was a sort of words. And it's okay. The God is with me, so it's okay. And then I go there. I was invited there, so I was sitting there. In front of them, Rambo was playing around with the kids. The chief asked me, 13 years of without your presence to these kids. You have no support to these kids. And now we heard that you are talking with these kids. So will you going to give me something else, make us please for that? They asked me this question. And about two questions was asked by your wife. Ex-wife. I've been with these kids, feeding these kids for so long, and I have a big pain in my life. Big pain in my life. There's nobody to solve me this painful that I'm normally carries. And she was mentioning that words, and then the people were just watching at me. And I'm just say so sorry to them. I'm sorry. Whatever things, hard work that you have brought these kids to this far, I'm sorry and sorry. Just forgive me the wrongs. I made a mistake. And then I just answered to this question. The wife, okay, the pain that you have, two things that happen to you. One, pain is, in biblical, pain is a normal in spiritual life. pain is normal, because a person who goes into complication part, painful situation, you have to carry the painful life in your life. And then second one, I told her, pain that you have before, it's like because we have not been go through a proper way and divorce. You have not been go through a proper way and get the divorce form and divorce me, but somehow, somewhat, you divorce me without your own way. That's why it could be the reason you are experiencing the pain in your life. That's what I gave him. And then whole community in here watching me was very pleased because I submit to them and my wordings went just balance them and whatever things that they want to make me maybe give them something else that was neutralized. My wordings neutralized their strength of the pain and then just they give me a very handshake. They please, they love me, they said, oh, that's good. You unite now. So now we release these kids onto your hands. From now onwards, you can school fees or their problems like school fees, their clothing, their everything. You, father, now take responsibility now. Now we release them onto your hands. When they give me this release by wordings, I was so happy and I was so cry. Even my tears dropped. I thank them and then we'll come back to school. Thank you. That's how this journey makes my complicated part get fixed. So I love this journey very, very with my 100%. I love this journey. Things unbelievable way in it happened in that way. Thank you.
Przez większość czasu czuliśmy się bezpiecznie, bo mieliśmy ze sobą przyjaciół, w tym naszego dobrego kolegę Rambo. O Rambo trzeba powiedzieć trzy rzeczy. Jest dobrym człowiekiem, lubi biegać i ma nietypowe imię. Rambo wysyłaliśmy wiele razy po różne rzeczy, na przykład po helikopter, o czym już wiecie, ale wysyłaliśmy też go w Kiundze, żeby kupił nam troszkę benzyny, którą potrzebowaliśmy do naszej kuchenki. Zobaczcie sami.
My sister, Michael and Carolina gave me $110 to tell me to go buy kerosene in Chinese men's too. And Chinese men asked me, he asked my name, what's your name? My name is Rambo. And then he said, my name is Bruce Lee. And I gave 10 kina to him, and he said, no, I sell 11 kina kerosene on the market, in the store. Then I said, I've got a 10 kina only. He said, no, I want 11 kina. Then I said, no, I've got just 10 kina only. And Chinese man, he said, when will you come and fail dinner? I said, after 3 months. After 3 months I will come and see you. Meet you in Kiungar.
To tylko niektóre z wielu historii, jakie przeżyliśmy tutaj w Papui Nowej Gwinei. Nasza 2-miesięczna ekspedycja dobiegła końca. Uznajemy ją za prawdziwy sukces. Przyjaźń polsko-papułaska kwitnie. A jeżeli chcecie śledzić dalsze losy projektu Anima Mundi, zapraszamy na naszego bloga i stronę na Facebooku.